in a warm December day from Center for Urban Economic Studies, Calcutta University. We are very happy to host this consultative workshop on intermediate public transport in Kolkata. Now, this particular workshop is a dissemination of the work that has been done in this project by three institutions. Center for Urban Economic Studies, Kolkata University, Center for Policy Research, New Delhi, and iTrans of IIT Delhi. We three of us together has worked on this project, and this is a sort of data dissemination from consultation from intensive workshop we are hosting. Now, just to go into the background, that why we started all these things. Now, when we work on urban issues, transport is of course a very important component for an urban center to be going. Now this transport consists of the transport network, the roads and bridges and everything, and along with the vehicles. The vehicles and the transport system altogether. Now it is sometimes said the best city is there where not the poor people has to spend a lot of money on transport, but where rich people also use the public transport. That is supposed to be the best transport system in any city. Now, unfortunately, Indian cities are plagued with the multiplicity of options as far as transportation is concerned, and of them in Calcutta, I'm now concentrating on Calcutta because our whole study is on Kolkata and its suburbs. We have many options. We have a public transport system consisting of the metro rail and the public and private buses, and then private options like chartered buses and so tram is also there in some routes. And the topic of our discussion today, that is the intermediate public transport, the auto rickshaws. Now, as we all know, these auto rickshaws first started plying in Kolkata much later than any other Indian city. It's about 1980 to 1983 where these auto rickshaws were first got registered for plying in Kolkata. Now at that time, that was thought as just as in any other city, it will be a fortnight's taxi type of thing that they will walk on meters and they will go as the passenger wants. But somehow that did not pick up in Kolkata, mainly because of the competition from the cheaper options like cycle rickshaws in the suburbs and the hand-pull rickshaws in the interior city, in the central city. And there are also pressures from the unions of these hand rickshaw pullers and cycle rickshaws and so on. So that did not pick up. Now what happened when the whole north-south metro from Taliganj to Domdom started flying in the early 90s, that was the time in absence of any other feeder service, these auto rickshaws became transformed themselves into stage carriages all on its own. There was no government support or no so-called rules and regulations according to that, but we saw that for all the stations in the metro corridor, starting from Taliganj to Damdam, auto rickshaws were there to give the feeder service. Now, from Taliganj, they went to east and west. They went up to Boria. In west, they went to different parts of Behala. In the another extreme point, Damdam, it was almost up to Mordomra that the auto rickshaws carried as stage carriage passengers. Then it came into for all of the stations except Netaji Bhavan, there were the auto rickshaw stand besides the metro station. And all of them, as we say in economics, came out informally. It was not when it was one or two or three and then 30, then more than that. And then came up the question of informal regulation in the form of auto rickshaw unions. And there were the political parties who started controlling these unions, that who will stand after the queuing, the fare structure, everything. Everything was controlled by these unions. Of course, that the main union was the thought, Dr. Partho Mukhopadhyay is here. He suggested me to go into the details of this auto thing. Dr. Pobitro Giri, our former director, was still with us at that time, and we conceived the project on this auto rickshaws. Auto rickshaws, and in 2010, we conducted a survey of the auto rickshaws, and then we started to find out that what are the routes in their plying and other things. Then we saw that officially there are 120 routes at that time in 2010. 120 routes lying over all over Kolkata Municipal Corporation area. But when we came down to the streets for the survey, we find that there is a difference between the listed routes and how the autos were plying. Now for some routes, it was fine. For some routes, we didn't find any data, so these routes were automatically stopped. For others, there may be an elongation of the route, that the official route is from, say, Howrah to Bondel Gate, but it lies up to VIP Bazaar. And also sometimes, there is just the opposite of it, that route was cut in. Route was cut in according to the demand. According to the demand, and of course, when as economists, we wanted to look into the demand supply framework. We also did a survey of the passengers, and there we found that the passengers went for metro because of their easy availability compared to the public buses and private buses. Maybe there is no buses in that route, especially in the suburban areas, in the peripheral areas like Garden Reach and others. Sorry. So there are differences from the official routes and the actual routes flying over it. And when we contacted the passengers in each terminal point of metro station, we conducted a survey of about 2,000 passengers, and we found that they found it convenient, they found it cheap, and most of all, they said they are for the regularity of autos, which was not available for the so-called dwindling bus service and others. But also they complained of many things like the obstinacy of the auto drivers, that they will not fly if there are not five passengers and others. Sometimes they load more than what can be taken in an auto and so on and so. But on the whole, there was a satisfaction on the part of the passengers that they are paying for something they are getting. So we thought that the demand side was all right. Then we also did some other things about who are these auto drivers, who are the auto owners, who are in this business and others. And that is a long story. But what we found, that part is totally informal. Totally informal, that is just like any other informal sector. These auto drivers and other workers, the starters and others, they do not have the benefit of social security measures and all those things. And most of them are sort of educated, unemployed. Most of them were, we found that they passed their class 10 standard. Some of them were even past the class 12 standard. But they said that they are lying in this route for say 8 or 10 years, and they are not very clear about their future. Now, after when we are doing this thing, then the High Court order came about the pollution. Now, of course, when the passengers ask for cheapness of the so-called mobile, the operators also going for profit maximization or cost minimization. So there is, from that point, we take up the issue of pollution. That to minimize their cost, they are going for some concoction, which is in Bengali called kata tel, and by that, they are minimizing their cost. Now, then the High Court order came, and there was a transformation to from this kata tel to LPG cylinders. Now, there are again a demand supply problem. Then we found that the number of registered autos, there is a difference with the number of autos flying, number of autos are many more, and there were problem with other issues like the number of cylinders available, and so-called petrol pump supplying cylinders are very less, so there are long queues policy research. They, along with the IIT Delhi, and we started another survey in a bigger scale in the Calcutta metropolitan area itself. Now, Center for Urban Economic Studies is very happy to join with them. Some of our students are here who took part in the survey, and finally, we have today this dissemination seminar. Now, with this, I welcome you all again in this consultative workshop. I hope that this will be a very interesting session. The CPR group, along with ITRAMS, will present their survey results and other things. And now I hand over to Mukta for the next session.
Dr. Pato.
Okay, this is Dr. Pato Mukhopadhyay.
Thank you all to the Shakti Foundation for supporting this study. I'll be very brief, and and contextualize what the broader context of the interest of the opinion is. Fundamentally, I think there is still a relative degree of confusion within various levels of government, not just in Bengal, but also in other states that we work in, as to how do you think of this particular vehicle. You think of this vehicle as a necessary evil, which will go away in the fullness of time as we develop, or do you think of this as an integral part of the transport system? And our method of dealing with them relates to essentially our conception of what this vehicle is. Calcutta is truly unique in the manner, and not just Calcutta, and from Calcutta, I think inspiration will take in other parts of Bengal, in the manner in which this vehicle is being used as a transportation system. Because it operates almost as a scheduled micro bus service with short routes, and what it does provide, therefore, what we came to understand is it provides a high frequency service which enables a lot more people to think of availing public transport, because it is very close to door to door and it is very frequent. So the two main issues why people do not prefer to go for public transport is the sense that they drop you at a place where you don't want to be dropped and you have to wait. Both these things are sort of mitigated by this particular method. Secondly, after the adoption of LTE, it's also a relatively green method of transport. But there is an issue here, and my colleagues who are taking the study will sort of elaborate on this. There really isn't a regulatory framework within our Motor Vehicles Act which can formalize the manner in which it operates in Kolkata. So one of the reasons we picked up this study is to try and understand what is it exactly that would need to be done in terms of interventions on the regulatory side, perhaps legal changes, perhaps changes in rules, which could, if this was, as we suspected, proved to be a useful method of service, how do we integrate this formally within the system? And this is especially important because as we move from large cities to smaller cities, modes of transport like this become even more and more important. And even in our large cities, to get people to move to much more public transport, these modes we are finding to be quite useful. So that was the broad context of the reason that we moved forward in this area, to try and understand how are these methods operating, what kind of issues arise in the regulatory side, and what kind of issues arise in the town. Second thing that we found also is, and as my, you'll find in the detailed surveys and structures, that contrary to many other places, the users of this mode of transport also have private vehicles. And they choose this mode of transport despite having private vehicles, which involve two-wheelers as well as four-wheelers. And therefore, compared to today, Delhi is trying to experiment with putting restrictions on cars, the variety of structures, etc., largely because of a large number of cars in the world. this mode of transport seems to be one way of providing a situation where even if people own cars, they do not necessarily use them as people. So ownership and usage can therefore be separated. However, there are also a number of challenges associated with this mode of transport, which will detail as we go along. But it's basically from these two broad aspects that one, it may be a use, looks like it is a very useful mode of transport, especially organized in the manner in which it was organized in Kolkata. There are many fewer vehicles in Kolkata and who provide a lot more service. The share of people using this is relatively high compared to other cities, but with many fewer vehicles on the road. So the way the system is organized seems to be very efficient, both from a capital expenditure point of view, the number of vehicles, as well as the amount of pollution created, etc., depending on the number of vehicles. So that's one basic structure, and we wanted to understand how, if is it possible to look at this thing in a more regulatory compatible manner. And secondly, we wanted to understand the extent to which a mode like this, the provision of a mode like this, can affect people's behavior in using public transport. And if so, how we can take it forward. So,
so my name is Anvita Arora, and I'm heading the organization. Before we go ahead, I just want to launch into the methodology of the study that we followed. So we had two parts to the work that we did. We did a fair bit of secondary data collection. There were some studies which had already been done. There is already a legal regulatory system existing within which these auto rickshaws fly, whether it's the Motor Vehicles Act and the other systems. We wanted to understand how is the transport system functioning in Kolkata and where does auto rickshaws fit in. We also looked at the media reports. You know, what is the perception of people about auto rickshaws? What are the issues, what are the barriers, responses, etc. So a large part of this understanding that we got will be the first set of presentations that will happen after we start the discussion on findings. The next thing that we did is we went to the ground and did a lot of primary data collection. So a lot of our understanding of how they are functioning, who are driving, what are the problems, right now, but anecdotal. So we wanted to have some numbers to capture the information. We did surveys of auto rickshaw drivers, the users, a strange entity called Starters who manage the auto rickshaw systems, the unions, the local government. We talked to the corporation, RTA, State Department, so just to understand the stakeholders and their perceptions. Now, quantitatively, what we did the route mapping. That is one of the interesting things that has come out of this study, and we'll be talking about it later. Is that we really mapped all the routes of the auto rickshaws using the GPS to be able to show that they are actually seamless. You can get out on from one, take the other. What are the difference from different types of route? There are different route density. We talked about that. We talked to the auto rickshaw drivers. There was a tab-based survey format that we had, went around. There was a team of people who did the surveys, so we had about 137 auto rickshaw drivers we talked to. We then talked to also the auto rickshaw users to get the other side of the coin. That was the quantitative work that we did. This quantitative work and the findings from that we'll be presenting in the post-club session, where we'll be talking about the whole situation empirically. We also did a fair bit of qualitative work. We did focus group discussions, at the stands, talk in more detail with the union and the starter. So the fair bit of anecdotal and qualitative work, which we'll also be talking about. Just to say that a lot of analysis that we are doing is still work in progress. So we are presenting our preliminary findings. The main agenda for us to discuss this with you is A, to understand whether what we are finding empirically is actually what you experience, because you are from the city, you are dealing with it on a day-to-day basis. So we want to see if there is a connect or a disconnect between the data finding and the experience on the ground. And then that opens up a lot of debates and discussions that we may have. So we mapped about 182 routes. We found that, like ma'am had said, Ratanala, that a lot of them were flying on the official routes, but quite a few of them were not flying on whatever the official routes were. They were parts of different PVDs. Some information we've got, some information we have yet to get of different PVDs. Some auto routes are cut, so they are only flying halfway or part of the way, some are fractured. So we are kind of trying to understand what is the difference from the official sanctioned system of operating to the situation on the ground. Again, a fair bit of this we'll be presenting in the afternoon session. Before we start our discussion, I just want to say that if you look at the programs that you all have, we've divided the day into two parts. So before lunch, we are going to have a short presentation from the team of very from a multidisciplinary team who's been working on understanding the institutional, the regulatory aspects. They are going to be talking about what is the ecosystem in which these auto rickshaws are functioning in the city. And post that, we'd like to have open the floor for a kind of a roundtable discussion to see what can be done about it, what are the big issues that we've flagged, how can we take that up further. Post the lunch session, then we'll be talking more about operations from the planning perspective, from the transport perspective, from the user agenda perspective, and then having a small discussion on how to address some of the problems that have been highlighted as from our surveys. So
this session will look at the regulation in terms of the history of why the IPT system in Kolkata is in the current form that it is. So I mean, we've gone through this before. IPT in Kolkata is very different from auto rickshaw systems in other cities. And what Manish will provide is the legal historical aspect. So what are the laws? What are the notifications? What are the amendments that have led to this structure? And Sharini and I will provide inputs from our qualitative data of sort of wherever we feel that the legal history doesn't cover a certain portion, we'll try and come in with our understanding from operators, from union leaders, from starters. But this data which we have is qualitative, and it could be subjective to the samples that we have. So this is where we'd like the delegates and the participants right now, when we have the feedback session, perhaps provide your understanding of the ground reality of the regulatory framework and help us sort of build this overarching narrative about IPT in Kolkata. And this will be the foundation upon which Anvita and the rest of the ITRANS team will talk about the operational aspects of IPT. So I'll now hand the mic over to Manish.
So I think Dr. Chatterjee in the morning has provided an introduction broadly to what the intermediate public transport is and why paratransit roads are necessary. So what we're going to try and do is a story of how auto rickshaw regulation in Calcutta came to what it is today and using the law. And one of the interesting things that I should mention before Mr. Solomon leaves is about how the regulatory system currently has very distinct sort of roles for different authorities. But the largest concentration of power is with the state government through the transport department. And where the traffic police is an integral part of the regulation scheme on the roads at the ground level, they don't find place to the same extent within the Motor Vehicles Act, where ideally transport planning is an integrated activity that involves multiple departments. The law, as it stands today, centralizes all of that within the State Transport Authority and the Transport Department. And perhaps when we come to the end of this presentation, when we look at the new road safety bill and whether that's taking us somewhere forward in that direction, we can have that conversation at that point. So Kolkata has a wide variety of transport, and in that sense it's among the most interesting megacity regions in India because it has different modes of transport across. So you have ferries, trams, buses, there are local trains, there's the metro rail, there are taxis, there's buses, and then there's also the non-motorized transport. Auto provide a brief overview before we go into the details. Unlike other autos in the country, don't run on metered fares, operate on fixed routes, and have fixed distance-wise fares. And I'll come to this in a little more detail. They operate under contract carriage permits. Mode of operation is practically like a stage carriage. And what this means to will come in a bit when we go into each of these aspects of the regulatory framework. But once upon a time, as Dr. Chatterjee told us, autos in Calcutta were like autos everywhere else in the country. They used to fly with metered fares. Today they don't. And what has happened in the interim is there are some aspects of the Motor Vehicles Act which provide a foundation, but there are provisions of the Motor Vehicles Rule and multiple notifications issued by the state government. And there has been a lot of litigation at the High Court as well about transport in Calcutta and about autos in particular that have led to our present situation.
Actually, what happened when we were doing the survey, we went to some of the older groups. You were saying, we are not from 19, so we did not start like from 2019, it's far back. Then there was some capital funding was there, or then the North-South funding was there. So the older operators said, we actually got to launch auto through the SESU stream, that's self-employment scheme for registered unemployed. So it was also important in the fact that it was started with the ownership, because who was registered entrepreneur will be given an auto and they will fly. So the drivers on brake were not, they came later. So they were saying that this were actually operating what mentioned was saying that on a just as a simultaneous or parallel system for the taxis, and they would operate on meter, and that was the Calcutta permit. And then for the North 24 permit and South 24 permit, it was actually divided for North permits and the South North South permits and something like that. After that, when regulations started occurring and then the pocket rules came up, because that is also we got from the field that they could not specify which case or when it happened, but said that the taxi operators actually objected that since we are actually going, flying, functioning on a meter basis throughout Calcutta, why another transport, another alternative? They were threatening like another alternative mode, but taking the doing the same thing. So it was, there was a case, but we didn't get any. We did not get any
cases from
but there have been interviews that repeatedly the older operators have complained that it actually started with a meter or on a contract tariff, but later it was transferred to pocket.
And that's an interesting part also of any political economy when a new set, when a new system comes in, people in the older system feel threatened, and therefore there's that resistance that happens. But broadly, this is the Motor Vehicles Act, and I'll come back to this. Since the entire fulcrum of this is around the permits, right? So what is a permit is essentially an authority for operating a motor vehicle as a public vehicle, as a public service vehicle, basically for carriage of passengers. And under the Motor Vehicles Act, it is mandatory to have a permit to operate a vehicle as a public transit vehicle. Right? And this is under Section 66. So the motor, the regional or state transport authority is the authority that issues the permit. And since the permit is mandatory, if you operate a vehicle without the permit, you're effectively operating illegally. And this is important because of the liability of the carrier in case there's an accident and other things. These things come into play. The other aspect is also taxation, because if you're operating it as a public vehicle, your taxation regime is different because you're taxed as a commercial vehicle. So the Motor Vehicle Act categorizes transport vehicles into different kinds of vehicles. So there's public service, there's private service vehicle, and then there are goods carriages, which are not for carriage of passengers. And public service vehicles broadly have two kinds of divisions, stage carriages and contract carriages. And contract carriages include further divisions called motor cabs and maxi cabs. Just to briefly explain what these are, the stage carriage, the essence of a stage carriage is that there are multiple people in the vehicle who are paying different fares for different parts of the journey. Or in other words, a stage carriage is like a bus, right, which flies between a particular point, and there are fares for each stage of the journey. In contrast to this, a contract carriage is essentially a contract. It's a vehicle that's taken on a contract. So if you take a taxi, you would enter into an oral contract with the driver to take me from this place to the other place, and we agree on a specified fare, which is the fare determined by that meter. What happens, and there are two categories. So a maxi cab is one which carries up to six passengers, and a motor cab is one which carries up to six passengers, and a maxi cab carries more than that. The taxis in Calcutta operate under motor cab contracts, under motor cab contract carriage contracts. Until 2003, until the late 90s actually, auto rickshaws in Calcutta were also operating under motor cab contracts, which were given to them as contract carriages, which is where they used their numbers. And then then we come to Rule 120 of the West Bengal Motor Vehicles Rules, and this was inserted in December 2003. And this is what determines the broad regulatory system for auto rickshaws in Calcutta today. I'm going to highlight three things from this which make autos in Calcutta very different from autos in other cities. Right? So, firstly, sub rule 2, which says that, which is basically the route determination system. It says auto rickshaws shall only ply on routes which are allotted to them by the RTA. So the RTA fixes the route for auto rickshaws. Auto rickshaws cannot ply wherever they want to ply. The second is that fares for auto rickshaws shall be fixed or determined by the state government. Okay, under this, whether how fare is actually fixed, we'll come to later on. And thirdly, there is no metering system in the auto rickshaw. Right? So rule 120 says that there will be no metering system, which means that effectively all these three rules together convert the auto rickshaw from a contract carriage to a stage carriage. The auto rickshaw is effectively operating like a mini bus along that route, where it picks up and drops off passengers. This is something that's unique to West Bengal, and in particular in this context. Under the Motor Vehicles Act, the state government, and it's interesting here because again the traffic police has no rules, having regard to the number of vehicles, road conditions, and other things, can restrict the number of contract carriages operating on a particular route. The state government can make this determination that we only need these many cabs here if there are because of the demand as well as traffic conditions. But the power is given to the state government or the road transport authority. Now, in exercise of this power, they've done a number of things. So, like in Calcutta, for example, they've restricted them to 125 routes, and under each route, you have a specific number of autos that are licensed to operate. And accidents that are occurring. So this is the preliminary basis on which this notification starts. And it says that henceforth no new permits shall be granted in Calcutta, and no new permit shall be granted for inter-district routes. And then it gives the Road Transport Authority powers to grant permits in respect of all the other districts, keeping in mind the local conditions. This notification and the policy is later was challenged in the Calcutta High Court, and the Calcutta High Court in 2009, when the case finally came to its end, directed that the state government should formulate a proper policy for auto rickshaws, because right now it's a very ad hoc policy with coming from one or two notifications and these rules. So they directed a full-fledged policy to be formulated. In response to which, they formulated a policy, and a substantial part of it was in this notification. So the notification at the beginning actually is a very long preamble, which goes into the various needs for regulating auto rickshaws and so on. So it continues with that same sort of, the language is similar, it continues with in the interest of the public, traffic conditions on the road, the need for transportation, etc., etc. And the essence of it is, they impose further restrictions on the number of auto rickshaws. So at the time these cases are going on in the High Court, the perception by the people who brought, by the perception of the court is largely that auto rickshaws are mostly unregulated space, and now they're sort of becoming they sort of becoming problematic for the city. So we have more restrictions coming. So no auto rickshaws on national highways, no auto rickshaws covering more than 30% of the existing bus routes. So if you already have a bus route, then you can't issue an auto permit on the same route because there's just going to be too many vehicles there, and so on. It also restricts the auto rickshaws on state highways. This notification gets challenged with the High Court again because the auto drivers and the auto unions once again took the state government to court saying these restrictions are excessive and they're not in the scheme of the Motor Vehicles Act. But the High Court upheld the validity of the notification. What also happened was that after the state government issued this notification, all the RTAs started rejecting permits based on these grounds. So we had mass rejections of large numbers of permits from especially the RTAs in the Calcutta region. So the RTAs in Calcutta, in Alipur, in Nadia, and Hubli, and Belkala. All of these RTAs started rejecting permits on a large scale. So all of these auto drivers said, our permits have been rejected. We've lost our livelihood because these permits have been rejected. And they went to court. The court upheld the notification itself. The court said, these restrictions are valid, but you must also now at the same time provide procedural safety to these auto drivers. So if you when you are making a decision on the permit, a hearing has to be provided to the applicant. You need to provide necessary documents to the applicant to make their case. And in case of rejection, a specific reason has to be provided for the rejection, and the reason should be only one of these reasons which are specified in the notification. So the RTA is required to specify what is the reason they are rejecting the permit, and the reasons can only be one of these reasons which are in the notification. So now the court's coming back to a point where they're saying that the auto drivers also need to be provided certain procedural safety so that their livelihood is not taken away without giving them an opportunity to explain their case and giving them a fair chance to contest for these permits. In March 2013, there are two other things that also happened subsequent to this. One is that in March 2013, there's an unreported judgment of the Calcutta High Court. So we've got this from secondary sources, which basically said that Rule 120 of this West Bengal Motor Vehicles Rules was in contravention of the Motor Vehicles Act, especially that last clause, there shall be no metering system. And they said that metering systems, they have directed the state government to implement the metering system in the auto rickshaw. This judgment was issued in March 2013. Till date, it has not been implemented. And earlier in 2015, there were reports of a contempt petition being filed in the Calcutta High Court against the state government, stating that the state government has committed contempt of court by not enforcing the metering rule in auto rickshaws. There has been no subsequent notification by the state government on as regards metering in auto rickshaws.
If the auto rickshaws are plying only in route,
yeah,
then why do they need this metering?
Exactly. So the challenge was to this entire rule 120. Right? So they go together. So if you look at rule 120, the route permit, which is part 2, the fare fixing, which is part 3, and the absence of meters, which is part 5, all of them go together as a system. So effectively implementing a metering rule means that you replace this entire system and go back to the original contract carriage system, which is how auto rickshaws operate at other points.
When you say about the code and the matter says the official drivers of the class, you have to be given a hearing. What was the exact nature of that hearing? They simply left it there, or they say that you have to state that the case does not fall within this code, or
yeah,
falls
yeah.
within this code, but despite that they have some...
No. So they only permitted rejection. So they said the only valid rejection of
and
the permit could be on these, and there has to be a specific nexus shown with each of these regulations.
So now that we sort of looked at the legal history of why the Kolkata IPD system is at the sort of format that it is, we thought we'd look at the sort of administrative aspect to the IPD system, and we're using routes as the fulcrum of this discussion. Just to be a little clear, Kolkata has about six PVPs,
However, within this study, we've looked at the KMA area has got 6, Kolkata has 3, but we've looked largely at Bertala because that is the one space where we had the 125 routes given to us, of which we've covered about 97 of those routes. So these are, this is the data that has come from Bertala largely and somewhat from Alipur. In terms of the permits, we're talking largely about the contract carriage permits that he was discussing before, but also the PBDs have to provide certificates. So whether it's a certificate of fitness that your auto rickshaw is compliant with all the PUC, the emissions, all of these kind of aspects, and the permits are sort of the new permits that come out. But a large part of the auto rickshaws that are bought and sold in the market are second hand, or they're old permits that are transferred to new auto rickshaws, but the permit is old. So this renewal of the permit or the changing of the name, the transfer of the name of the permit, all has to happen between the operator and the PBD. So if you have permits being released, the transport department and the PBD have a notification, and operators have to come to the PBD to apply for them. If the operator themselves requires some sort of change in the name or the certification, then they go to the PBD and get their work done. The reality from our study was that generally there was not a direct interaction between the operator and the PBD, and it was done through an agent. So an agent knows when the permits are out, and sort of you are in touch with agents, or the agent knows that someone is looking for a permit. If you want to get your even certificate of fitness done, you go to the agent, and the agent knows who to go to. This has some bearing on the costs, because you already have a closed system. We don't have an open system in Kolkata. So there are costs because you have a fixed number of permits that you can have, and then the agent costs that come with it. So,
it's like two ways. One is the release of the new permits, as she's saying. So there are certain routes where the ceiling has not yet reached, the maximum number of permits has not yet reached. So they occasionally, from time to time, the PBD releases, or the transport department through PBD releases this permit. So what happens, the operators, we have been found through the survey, the operators saying that even if it's released by the PBD, it actually goes to the agent. So now what the agent do
is that agents
who actually stand in the Bertala, if you just go to Bertala or PBD, they are the first ones who will come what you actually need.
Agent is represented where here? Union.
No,
PBD
and operators.
Just PBD and operators. But suppose I want to be an agent. So can I be an agent on my own? What is the...
Is
the
that
do I have to get registered or something?
No,
I
have to get registered. It's really the doubts.
So it's like, whenever we go to Bertala, it's like they are the ones who first come, what we need to do, whether we need to pay tax or things like that. So these, the operators are stating that even though there is a notification for releasing permits or things like that, they are the ones who get hold of these permits. And so what if they don't release these permits at a time? So if they are suppose...
Just for clarification sake, let me just ask you one question. That means these agents are there, everyone knows. Agents are allowed to play here just to make the system informal. Because previously everything is coming through formal channel. There is some notification, some rule, some law, etc., etc., some regulatory authority. But suddenly this agent group, they are entering the picture, and then everything started becoming informal. So is it the entry point of informality in the system?
Yeah, it's entry point, and it is very much because not that suddenly, even if the suppose for payment of CA for tax, every year they have to do that. So it's like we have asked the operators, why don't you go directly and pay it? So they said
suppose operators cannot, because individually no one can break that. That means the system is accommodating this informality, and then the system is trying to clear it formally. So I wish Mr. Solomon could be here, because how this informality and formality, formal structure will work together.
Why
they are not doing it through open tendering or, just through web? Where everyone is directly.
It's supposed to be open tendering, but as with a lot of different processes do get taken over by agents or through networks that you know. And also, just to clarify that since this is under the PPD, even if Mr. Solomon was here, this would not be under his
jurisdiction. But the issue is, you know, in case of traffic management, they remove this. They may be directed through this database management.
So, I mean, when we're talking about issues of transparency and issues of efficiency, which are larger things, which really we need state government representatives over here, because what we have are only the viewpoints of the operators, the union leaders. We don't have, as of now, the opinions of the state government. So it would be important for them to be represented before we get too deep into the discussion, is my point.
It's also the body saying that it is the formal which is accommodating this informal, because what the operators is getting, even if you want to pay tax or save directly, what happens when you are going to the PVD, the first thing who's sitting on the cash counter is directing you go there. So if we try, even the papers are in almost normal condition and proper condition, they will actually harass you, will direct you to another counter and things like that. Ultimately, what you have to do is go to the agent. He will actually take care of. So, it's the formal system is actually encouraging the intrusion of the informal. That is one. The second thing
is to the permits have any expiry date or something.
Yeah, it has to be this
every 5 years, 6 months, 5 years. So, they are also saying the same thing that while they are going for the permit renewal cases, that even if papers and things are in normal, proper condition, they won't even look. The first thing from the other side of the counter, there is a go there.
There is a connivance between them and they are beneficiaries.
Definitely. Because what you said, that there is a notification.
There is an expression that there is a corruption entering into the picture through them.
So what the operators are saying is that even if they are paying higher amount, they are saving time. Because they have to go back and operate. They will be running the loss if they give so much time for payment of tax and things like that. So ultimately they fall into
then further on take the discussion to
is it functioning well, business as usual works well, or is there something that should be kept, some things that should be changed? Also the discussion on the starters and the...
Yeah, that's what we talked about.
Yes.
Maybe I should have explained the map a little bit. So the, if you look at the diagram, the parts which are in blue are formal structures, but also the arrows in blue mean that the process is a formal process. So the arrows are now orange or ochre. Then those are informal processes which are very much a large part of the regulatory function of the system. So the next sort of focal point we'd like to come to is the union. So there are multiple unions and they're all linked to different political parties. Sharini will explain this a little bit more, but we've also observed that the union that is there at the stand level is normally affiliated with the political party in power, though you can have multiple unions at the same stand. In terms of what the unions, there's sometimes a difference in what the unions see their job and their purpose and what the operators see their purpose as. From our study, about a little more than 50% pay the unions a small amount, so say about 120 rupees on average. This is just like very numbers just like taken out. About 120 rupees in the month for the everyday running of the stand, which includes so that the infrastructure that they build for the stand, there may be places for people to sit, and it may be just having a starter. Now this starter is not there at all stands. It is an individual who regulates the functioning of the stand. So which auto rickshaw goes when? Are you part of this stand? Are you following the correct route? There are various parts that the starter focuses on, and he gets a sort of daily wage for this. Normally the starter is part of the union, though we have some instances where the starter may be not part of the union because perhaps the stand over there decided that they do not want to have a union, so they hire someone who is like a starter. So basically there is someone at the ground level who is sort of a managing person and maybe an operator himself. The unions also state that they provide some sense of security. So in case there is a problem that the auto rickshaw has, whether it's an issue of disagreement with say a passenger, whether there's some problem with the state, in the initial stage, or if there's been an accident in the initial stage, the union is supposed to provide some support to the auto rickshaw driver, sometimes for medical support for the passenger as well. It changes from case to case. But this is the sort of larger picture of which the union is.
Where the starters are located? At the terminal points?
Or? At the stands. So they have, they're there for a particular set of hours, and that's why it's very difficult for us to get starter interviews, because they're extremely busy. When they're at that point, they're very busy.
The interesting part of the starter is that we did not go there deliberately to interview the starters and things like that. What happened when we started with the surveys of auto drivers, we were regularly diverged or directed towards the starters. Why don't we go and talk to the starters? He knows about the routes, he knows about the stands, he knows about how many autos goes. And also another fact is that the starter is somebody who's not mobile. He's not operating at that point, he's standing there. So what we found, then we incorporated starter, seemed like maybe he's a representative of the union, but as we progressed through the entire survey, we found that there is a diversification, because every stand, whichever it has a starter, has a different story. So sometimes it is who is an older operator, used to operate once upon a time, now he cannot operate. That person has been employed as a starter by the operator, that at least he looks after the stands and things like that. He collects certain fees. There are two forms of fees. One is the fee to the stand. That is for the maintenance of the stands and things like that. And then there is a very formal fees for the union. Fees towards the payment to the union. So some of the operators say that this is actually not payment to the union. This is actually payment to the stand, or it is for us only. And some say no, it is payment to
the stand.
Payment to the stand is to maintain the stand if there is any problem, like if there is...
What are the operating parts of it? Just giving the fare charge or anything of that sort? Or
no,
any shape? for him to take rest? No, nothing about that.
No, no, not, not they don't give a fair chat. Fair chat is again another interesting. It's a different part. I'll be coming to that. What starters do is mainly control the who comes first, who leaves. Like this, if there is somebody violates this rule, or it's like one thing. The second thing is the starter also acts as a link by between the union and the operator. Sometimes it happens that the route secretary is also the operator. So there the starter is only for following.
Does he listen to the complaints of the passengers?
He formally receives the complaints of the passengers, and there may be some feud on the road where both the passengers or the drivers come. Then what the starter do? Starter actually asks another auto driver that whether you were there at that point, somebody, because they are all flying side by side, something like that, whether you have seen what has happened or things like that. So that is what starter is supposed to do. So sometimes the starter is mainly collecting, is not that powerful, but in certain points the starter is quite, because he is actually the representative of the
union.
So how is it the union?
No, 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 no. He said from the parent. From the parent. So it's
there was a survey conducted by the students of the Geography Department of Calcutta University, and Professor Shukla was in charge of that, and result of that survey showed that 70% auto, they are not registered auto in certain routes. They didn't cover so many roads, but they were working on 6-7 roads, and I've seen that report in detail, that 70% was unregistered auto. So how are you accommodating unregistered auto in this flowchart? Because here everyone has got permit. So is it the case that after 2004, whatever is now flying on road, everyone registered?
Because
we have seen that there was one, permission from union that was registered in some union, not with the motor vehicle department. And 70% auto was unregistered, and there, but here, whatever diagram you have drawn here,
it seems like everyone has.
It seems that everything is coming from that part.
So maybe Sharini can sort of step in if what I'm saying is not in keeping with the, because she was doing the field, leading the field work. But our questionnaire asks an operator whether they have a permit or not, or we talk to them about permits. There isn't, but we don't actually ask to see the permit.
No, because when they are having the permit from the union, they also think they are have permit.
Exactly.
Because they pay for that.
So just understanding it. And then also the fact that, so we, what we accept is, yes, permit from whom, and the fact that you have a number. So if once you go outside the KMC boundaries, there are certain auto-rickshaws that apply without a route number on the auto-rickshaw, you have a route name. Now these auto-rickshaws may not have a permit from the PD.
So those who have number, they also may not have permit, because I'm talking about within Calcutta 7-8 routes where the geography department students, they conducted their survey, that is from Kalighat to some place, within proper Kolkata.
When KP looks at these kind of violations, you find a large number of auto-rickshaws which are plying without permits. I mean, the impression that we have from our survey is they're reporting having permits. We have not seen them, so we don't know whether they are union permits or structures, or whether it's a.
Some permits.
In terms of, we have also seen reports that there's a large number of unregistered autos. But what I would like, if there's any information from the police as to whether this is something that you've, because if that is the case, you often do actually get in touch with autos and you would stop them for some violation.
I've got something to contribute here from my experience at Yadavpur terminal. There are some flying sort of things that those who do not have permits, but they connive on the spot and perhaps share certain things with the starter. As that's why I asked you, where are they located? And they allow them to be on the line. Okay, this is number one. There is another type of, they have permit, but still then they illegally operate. Permit is saying illegally operates. Suppose one route has been sanctioned somewhere in Sunan, but it pays the union some amount of money, but it comes to Jadavpur. Here is the case because I was involved.
That we do have.
Yes,
that
is also something. But it is a very nice flow chart to my mind. But it does not include those things as a matter.
One thing I want to substantiate is that the kind of things you are actually talking about, the unofficial cut-throughs, fractured routes, and unregistered things that come in subsequent when you are present on the project.
And there's also, for example,
this discussion is more about the administrative framework.
Yes.
So we are not presenting the findings completely from the operational aspects.
So if you're looking, at that particular diagram, one of the issues that perhaps this diagram could include, which would be different, is a particular route may have auto rickshaws operating on them who are authorized, for example, from Kolkata, which is the Beltala routes, as well as from North Chobbish Parganah, which is the Barasat. So, for example, in Salt Lake, you would have some routes which are going from Ultradanga into Salt Lake, which are authorized by Kolkata, some branch of Beltala, somewhere in the structures, and but also routes which are run by Barasat. So in that sense, there is a little bit of a gray area about the notion of the permit, because there's an overlapping route jurisdiction. That clarity may or may not be there within the RTA.
So
but I was...
this flowchart is not for that.
No, it's not for that.
Because my justification is, maybe it's your creation, that is, all the activities involved in the entire process for the smooth running as it does right now, this could be the flowchart. And in that, there are certain areas which are prone to be corrupt, and corruption is just through that. But the other thing that we are saying now, that can hardly be incorporated in this.
Yeah, but which is what I was just wondering from the police as to whether do you find a large number of autos flying without authorization?
Yes. One flying autos.
I'm just looking at what is the on-the-ground experience of the police when they actually...
I see.
The main thing is proper Calcutta. We are not getting this type of complaint very often. Very rare cases. And when we come across, we definitely intercept them and prosecute them according to law. But cases are very few. Because public complaint is very...
No, it's not few. They are very frequent. But they are not reported.
Sure. Because I mean,
they are not reported. That's
three complaints. If you expect it, then they will
be
reported.
I know a couple of cases where I do my
But sometimes we are keeping suddenly changing. But if you don't come across, then it is not possible for them. And it is not possible for us also to check huge number of people. For
I'm just asking the normal course of your enforcement. When you stop an auto rickshaw for a traffic violation, or you do your random checking at variety of points, is this an offence that you find frequently or rarely? That's the rare. So my own is, I'm not quite sure, while I understand the story, there is also an economic story on the other side, which is the people were saying that this particular route is supposed to have 150 autos. It is not in the best interest of the 150 authorized autos who have got the permits to allow another 150 to come in and ply without permits. I mean, there's obviously going to be some accommodation to specific political parties and so on. And what we hear from the field in our focus discussions is, yes, somebody is connected, somebody knows something, we have to accommodate them, and usually we do it by getting a permit from Barasat or getting a permit from somewhere else and allowing them to run this place. But the extensive unregistered story that one has seen both in the media reports and a couple of media studies, we are unable to substantiate that. I mean, there's not something that we are finding. So in that sense, I think there is a somewhat difference between when we do this large extensive structure as well as doing the structure as well. And maybe between in the last 10 years, yeah, things have been,
over the last 10 years,
things have changed. Yes.
Changed.
All these points which you all have raised are extremely important, are actually part of the regulation. So if you see the upper arrow which goes towards the union in terms of regulation, what you're talking about, the union having control, so the union sets the fares, whereas Manish clearly demonstrated that the union does not have the authority to set a fare. It does set the fares. While we do have routes which are set by the government, these are sometimes cut routes. So the union decides how long you can go on that route, whether you can delay. Sometimes there are discussions with the police and you get permissions.
The union decides
these upper things are all informal.
And even in cutting also, the adjustments that are made, that is also in the approval of the
So actually the union plays the primary role in the operation lockdown.
Is there correlation between the fares which are set by the transport department for their actual authorization?
No, actually, when we went to Belkala, where we needed for route charts and notified route charts, we also asked for whether you have a notified fare chart or something. Just directly told to us, we don't do that. You need to go to the ground, you will know.
There are no fares published by the
that is one. The second thing is the being of the union, because union is actually the pivot for operating the entire operation. Though there is a formal system and things like that, though we say union is informal, but they play the dominant role. So the second thing is that where you say in Jadavpur area, which is specifically under Arjun. Now what's happening over there, for Belkala PPD, we have a new chart. Route number corresponding to the route number, there is a route name, and then is a maximum selling limit. So in the fringe area, that is in Jadavpur or Behar area, which was not previously under Kolkata police, now recently has been extended. What we are seeing that wherever there is a seal, what people are doing, that they are breaking the seal, this is through again through Indians and things, and they are getting permits from Aliti. So the same route. Jadavpur is a very important area for that.
I didn't like to say that, but fact it is that they dictate Alipur.
This is something very open.
Something very difficult to say and to say from this point.
Yes, so there are again some.
Fact it is, they dictate them.
They are dictated. So that is something very important. And again, for the routes, there are certain routes which are, those on an average, which is 8 kilometers or 9 kilometers.
This should come in your report.
Yeah, it is there.
This should come in your report.
Unions play a very, sometimes like that they are the sole
authority.
Sole authority in this country. So that is. And the second thing is that what you are saying, that there are very few stands where they actually give the actual number. So it's like they give a very rough. If you ask the operator, if you ask the starter, okay, we have 500 options. Okay, we have 130 autos or something like that. If we go and check with the route chart, it does not comply with that. So there are very few stands which have actually been able to give us.
They are not capable of, as an
fact.
I don't know whether
the
they have got an estimate.
Then there are the running
autos.
They have 10,000
permitted autos. Permitted autos in Calcutta.
It is complete representation.
It is production.
We have to wind up this session by
4:30. Also, many of these issues can be discussed in greater detail in the session after lunch, which is on the operational aspect. The other interesting thing also is, given the centrality, if you look at the number of arrows that come out in the union here, so the union is clearly very central to this process, and the union is not recognized in this process. Right? So the union itself is registered under the Trade Unions Act, but the union within the Motor Vehicles Act has no space in this regulatory structure, right? which is a significant gap, right? Significant disconnection between what the law is and how regulation works on the ground. And that's a question we can consider at a later point when we're looking at what is the way forward in a sense.
Perhaps in your draft report you have already considered that.
Yes. And also winding up this slide. Since we've already talked about the regulation of the union, which the union does at the ground level. This is not formal, but it does move at the ground level. The police also play another important part, which is looking at, again, if someone breaks the rules, if the if an auto rickshaw passenger has an issue with the auto rickshaw, they may take it up with the police. So that kind of regulation is formal and on the ground. And that kind of is the summary of the administrative and regulatory aspects of the IPD system in Kolkata. And yes, and Manish has some.
Before we come to the final question, this is one aspect which I will flag on the regulatory side, which will be discussed in greater detail by Amrita after lunch. One other significant intervention that the Calcutta High Court made was in 2008-2009. So in the mid-2000s, just as a background, in the mid-2000s, the Calcutta High Court started hearing a lot of environmental litigation that was being taken primarily by Mr. Subhash Datta and several other activists and organizations based in Calcutta about the environment in general, right? So from the Calcutta wetlands to air quality and various things. So in relation to the air quality, one of the things that the Calcutta High Court directed in 2008 was that vehicles above 15 years old should be taken off the roads. And this included, and all the auto rickshaws should be converted to four-stroke auto rickshaws because they are less polluting. This was obviously, this was objected to by the auto rickshaw because the majority of the auto rickshaws were two-stroke auto rickshaws which had been there for almost 15 years. They were facing an issue of loss of livelihood, plus the economic cost for them was also very high of getting a new auto rickshaw, getting it converted to a four-stroke. Subsequently, there was the state government also was a party in that entire process, and they proposed, the then transport minister proposed that LPG conversion of auto rickshaws to LPG would be feasible even with two-stroke auto rickshaw. I think Jadavpur University is involved in that process, the technical part of that process. Eventually, the High Court approved the scheme for conversion of auto rickshaws, of all auto rickshaws from petrol or diesel or whatever other fuel, mixture of fuels that the strategy was describing in the morning. They approved the conversion to LPG, and there were particular time frames that were set. I think it was the end of 2009. Was the eventual time frame that was set for conversion to LPG. The state government at that point of time also stepped into the picture and announced that there would be a financing scheme which would help auto rickshaw drivers convert their rickshaws into LPG. So the cost was about, just to give you a ballpark estimate, the cost was about 1.25 lakhs to convert an auto rickshaw into an LPG auto rickshaw. And the public sector banks were sort of roped into this. So they paid about 90,000-95,000. The state government gave a grant of about 10,000, and the remaining amount was paid by the auto rickshaw drivers. There are studies from the field when we were speaking to auto rickshaws in the field. They all of them recalled this financing scheme. At that point of time. So auto rickshaws in Calcutta have subsequently, from that point of time, been converted to LPG. And LPG, by the way, is also a condition now on the permits. On all subsequent notifications and permits, they state that auto rickshaw shall run on LPG fuel only.
What's the financing scheme available only to auto rickshaws working manual permits?
For replacement.
By that logic, all the auto rickshaws should not have been converted, got the assistance to convert to LPG.
Substantiate the fact that there are more coverage of courses. So as we just sort of wrap up, these are the questions we'd like to leave with you, and have a debate about this perhaps when we come back. Does the existing regulatory framework respond to the needs of the sector on the ground? Should the law incorporate and recognize existing regulatory mechanisms on the ground which are currently outside the legal framework? And how do we use the learnings from this data feed into the proposed new regulatory framework for transport under the road safety bill?
Just very quickly on the road safety bill. The road safety bill is currently pending with the central government, which is at the ministerial level. It has gone through 6 revisions, so what is present now is the 6th draft of the bill. And it's changed very substantially each time. And what Mr. Solomon was saying earlier about messengers, there are different interest groups involved, and each of them has tried to influence each version of the bill. So one version comes up and someone else comments. So the current version of the bill basically sort of reduces the permit system to just one unified transport permit. So basically all what we discussed earlier, stage carriages, contract carriages, motor cab, maxi cab, etc. There is only going to be one passenger transport permit, one goods transport permit. Right? So all vehicles, whether it's like an auto rickshaw or a bus or anything else, will be covered under one unified transport model. Whether that is an effective solution here, whether that is going to complicate matters, etc., remains to be seen. But these questions are something we can consider in our subsequent session.
So this is for the presentation. Now we may have a very short discussion on what is presented. I would like to ask Professor Shobhila Banerjee, who was almost the first to start with work with automobile pollution in Kolkata and also auto rickshaws. So, Shobhila, please respond to what has been said. You have already responded, but in a formal structure.
And I'm really surprised that you are asking for more. But anyway, I just want to share one thing, because what I'm telling, that is before conversion to LPG. And so I don't know whether it is still continuing or not, but that time the way these unauthorized auto rickshaws, they are coming in the, in particular route, the thing was, suppose a motor vehicle department is giving permit for 100 auto rickshaws in particular route. And then they are, with that 100 auto, the union is controlling the entire thing, and suppose they are issuing 200 more additional permit from the union. And what they are doing, they are issuing a sheet of paper which is telling them, suppose one particular auto is having, say, 10 times they will cover the route in a day, and or say, let me make it 12 times. They will allow them to have that much of fuel, which will allow them to ply 4 times. And they will then allow them to have one bottle of extra fuel. If there is traffic jam or anything, they are running out of fuel, they can use that part to come back to the stack. And then they are issuing like that to 3 autos against one permit. And so one is a motor vehicle's permit, and 2 are the permits given by the union, but everything is controlled by the union. That's the way this unauthorized auto that was working. But I don't know after conversion to this LPG engine or things, because the study I am referring to or whatever I have seen, that is prior to 2004.
Yeah, but what happens, you know, after conversion, this is another thing that came up, we have found in the peripherals also, that they started recording the registration number, were converted. So it's like when we went to Alipur or Barashat, we asked, do you have a room chart or things like that? They said that we have only those records which has already been converted. So that is the thing. So the record is only for them, is there. So the
and nobody told you that conversion is 100%.
No. At least not in the periphery. Because periphery can again open, because when we went for the diesel auto and things like in the periphery, we got it, not in within the area. They were very open. We are illegal autos. And we get permission from the councillors and MLS. This is again
another legal part. I came to know that time, because all my experiences are very, very dated. So I'm not claiming that that is relevant for your survey. But what I've seen there, that suppose you are buying a new auto, only then you need to get it registered. But suppose you are converting a two-wheeler to auto with a rebuilt engine, then you don't need to get registered. The registration requirement was like that. So whoever converting, suppose Delhi is banning all old two-wheelers. They are coming to, not that in a country where the thrown away Hawaii chappal is heavily used, they are the working vehicle. If you say it is banned, it will not be used there, but it will be used somewhere else. And so it will go to the body part department, and the engine will be retrieved from there, body will go somewhere else, and that engine will be rebuilt. And it turned converted into auto in most of the cases. But if it is on rebuilt engine, then you do not need to get it registered.
No, actually,
and so that is the supply of illegal auto in the peripheral routes.
How will the number work out in that case?
Number is given by the union, because they are in total control. Against that number, they used to issue that fuel cheat. That was there. That's a brilliant example of parallel informal regulation. It is absolutely regulated. No one can enter there without their sanction. Absolutely regulated.
That is the exact term. There is a parallel progression.
Yes.
Between this flowchart, if we club together three autos, union start as agents, then it is a complete parallel progression, parallel to PVD. And this is also highly decentralized.
Yeah.
any auto operator need not go to the PVD department to reduce the parking. He can do it at the stands here because the entire panel is
going to be
decent.
There is informal regulation that is very, very well structured. Not that there is no structure or anyone can go and anyone can hit the road.
There is a structure and not even, like even I think so the agent
I found that structure so incentive compatible. Yeah. It was so excellent structure.
Work a little more on those linkages.
Yes, yeah. There is a linkage between the agent and the other three.
So, can
we
change the system of
dominance
by giving
the answer? Madam, it is not within one. It is within the total requirement of PVD and the public. We are not concerned about this renewal or giving the permit, whatever it is. Police have nothing to say about it.
But from the operational perspective, right, given that the union also controls how the autos are moving into the stand and moving out of the stand, so it also becomes, in that sense, some kind of a traffic regulation issue there. So how do you view the unions? Like, do you think the unions are being an important player in this process?
This is nothing. We are not facing the union. General approach of time from the stand. If we find anything untoward, then we are taking the legal action. Otherwise, we don't have anything to say to them.
Okay.
We are just checking on the papers. If every paper is all right, what do we do? We can't do anything.
Do you
know about the normal checking process? No, madam, it is not possible to do this sort of things on a regular basis. But we are doing it sudden checking whenever any complaint comes. We are checking it. If there is any violation, that time we are checking all the people.
I have a question for the presenter. In the last slide, one of the questions that you spoke of, when you're saying that we need to look at the needs of the sector, I have a question as to what do you understand as the sector? So the sector comprises different stakeholders. So is there some kind of prioritization about who amongst those stakeholders or whose needs would you prioritize over the other in case of some kind of conflicting needs? So are we focusing on the auto rickshaw drivers or the passengers or the unions or what exactly?
I guess regulation should have all sides in terms of from the field. The auto rickshaw drivers feel very unrepresented because whether it's in the media or whether it's a discussion with authorities, whenever there is a complaint put against an auto rickshaw driver, they feel that there is no space for them to give their side. They are always assumed to be wrong. So I wouldn't say that there should be a priority on the operator side, but I think if there is a larger feeling that they are not heard, maybe making space to make sure that they are heard.
It's actually I just want to like that. Even there is a union and strong role of the union, what we have found with the operators and sometimes the union members who are actually the root committee members, and they are saying that the unions or the higher political level, they look for that they actually try to satisfy the passengers and not us. So
right.
Sometimes
that's
they are also under huge pressure. So
taxi
even under because what we do when we started, we had a perception of being a passenger. So we thought that we only do the unions, they don't go to, but they have also some form of complaints because they say when their interest needs to be looked at, when there is a conflict between passenger and auto, it's like that the entire thing goes towards the passenger and not to the operator. They can also have a side to the entire story and things like that. So it's union is presented or it's there in such a way that sometimes even the operators are pressurized. Because Indians also look to
the interest because
I have found even the starters or the operators saying that this route has a high political pressure. So we can't do anything. It's like that within the same party, within the same color, these types of pressure also exists. So that also means that it also makes that operator as a very important stakeholder. So that is
the other thing when we're looking at regulatory framework, rather than prioritizing individual stakeholders, one way of looking at it would be to keep the top priority at the objective of the regulatory framework or the objective of the policy. Right? So is the objective of having a regulatory framework that we have an efficient transport system? Right? And an efficient transport system includes everybody. Right? Or is it the objective that we have a less congested city, we have a less polluted city, we have a city where everybody is able to move around efficiently, and so on and so forth. So if we look at it from that frame, that might provide us a more useful indicator of how we decide to balance the interests of various stakeholders within that system.
And on that note, I think this is the time to end this, because we will have further inputs onto that side of the story. What do users need? What do drivers want? Operationally, is this efficient or not efficient? So we'll have a few more inputs post lunch, and then we can take this discussion further, looking at both the regulatory and the operational side, and then assess again what is the value of all the grades in the system. There is a CEO. So no more auto rickshaws are allowed, which leads to the discussion of a more parallel informal system that is operating to allow for the fulfillment of the demand, because it's officially the supply is capped, right? But the system is working. There is a demand for mobility. People need to move. People need to move. Not everybody owns a car. Not everybody owns a two-wheeler. There is a lot of public transportation availability and use. Still, there is a demand for auto rickshaws. So what is it that the auto rickshaws provide as a service to us? It is working. It was not allowed to work. The demand was not allowed to be met through formal systems, so it's being met through informal systems. So throughout the whole debate for us, if we now look at it from an operational efficiency perspective, the interesting thing is, well, it seems to be working right now. However, there are still certain issues. It is not sustainable that everything keeps working in the grid. But maybe not everything needs to be formalized. So I think towards the end also we'd like to flag these questions again. How much of all the operations of the way the system is working, the way the supply, formal plus informal, is trying to meet the demand of mobility, how much of it needs to actually be regulated or formalized, and how much functions the way it does, and what is the value of all the stakeholders who are legally termed in grey, but what is the value they are bringing to the table in creating these operational options for us. So we are trying to put together a baseline. This is an understanding that we've got from the surveys that we did. We presented them at the IT in the morning. So from the surveys of the auto rickshaw drivers, of the auto rickshaw users, just a very quantitative understanding of the baseline as it stands. For auto rickshaw drivers, we see that who are they in terms of income groups? Most of them earn a little less than 500 rupees per day. If you look at their actual earnings, not just the income, so there are certain costs that they have to meet. We have a fair detailed understanding of the different types of costs, whether they are EMIs or rents, etc. We have not yet kind of gone into those discussions. We are still cleaning up that data. But all in all, whether they are owned autos or they are rented autos, again, that is an interesting thing. Whether you own an auto or you rent an auto, pretty much you end up earning about 500 bucks or a little less at the end of the day. So if you look at the fact about 30%, again trying to profile these auto rickshaw drivers, about 30% of them own a house and own auto rickshaw. Right? So that places them in that a secure kind of profile space. About 26% of them, that top right red corner, are renting a house and renting a mortgage. So an insecure tenure kind of space. And then there are people who have owned their houses but rent auto rickshaw, people who rent houses but own auto rickshaws. We have a variety of profile of people. If we look at from us, for us, operationally, what does that mean? Where are the parking locations? That becomes an important question for us. Most of them, whether they are owning a house or renting a house, park it near their homes. At the planning level, it raises the question, have we designed parking spaces for these operations? Or is it like cars are parked on the road, which is also parked on the road? It's work functions like a personal vehicle when it comes to parking. Some people park a little further away from the road, but still within their own jurisdiction. But there is this set of grades with both house owners and rental. You see that about 51% working auto rickshaws, maybe some disabled people who are parking auto rickshaws in a garage. And people who are parking auto rickshaws in a garage because there is no space there near homes, no secure space near their homes to park this. They are actually, most of them who are parking are actually paying a fee to the garage. So this system also exists. While most of them are parked next to their home, so they are just occupying road space. The system of parking in a garage and paying the fee to it, it also exists as a part of the system. If we look at route lengths, what is the route distances or the route lengths that is called we define the routes as about 1 to 3 kilometers, the short routes, medium routes 3 to 5 kilometers, long routes which are over 5 kilometers. And we find there's an even distribution. So we have short routes, medium routes, long routes in moderations. We find obviously that the average fare increases as the route length increases, you are earning more because. But the variance is very high on the long route. So they get the short route, short distance commuters as well as the long distance commuters. So the variance becomes quite high. So this is, we have some more data on auto rickshaw drivers, especially with regard to what are they spending on, what are they paying on fines, what are they paying for permits, what are they paying as EMIs, how much loan have they taken, but we are still in the process of analyzing that data because, like I said, we are, this is still a work in progress. We are just coming up with the preliminary results. Now, auto rickshaw users, the demand side, that was the supply side, the demand side of this. Who are they? We find that majority of the auto rickshaw users are kind of below the age of 30 and almost equal number of males or females in most age groups that we find abuse the auto rickshaw. So 31 to 40, the working age group is the primary user of auto rickshaws in the city. Or as also is 18 to 25, which is your education. This is also borne out by the purpose of this. So if you look at it from the purpose occupation or the purpose of trip, we find that most of the people use auto rickshaws to go to office. Or they use to go to schools, colleges, education spaces. So the daily commuting trips, so we find that these are the regular trips are the ones which are made for office, for education, are used, are the auto rickshaws. It's not infrequent trips so much as a frequent trips. Now, very interesting thing, and I want to flag this because we are, it becomes an important issue for us for calculating the benefits of auto rickshaws later, is that 37% of people who are auto rickshaw users actually own their own vehicles. So it's not insubstantial. And out of that 37%, there is more than half are four-wheeler owners. They have cars. They have cars and so the opportunity of using a four-wheeler or the opportunity of using a two-wheeler is there, and they are still using auto rickshaws. Next. If you look at it from the perspective of their income status or the ownership status, we find very clearly you see the blue is the two-wheeler, the red is the four-wheeler, and with less than 10,000 they own no vehicle. They are still using auto rickshaws, but they are not owning any vehicle. Between the 10,000 to 20,000 category of household, of personal income, they are two-wheelers owner or they have bicycles. Very few people have cars in this category. As the income increases, the car ownership increases. Right? And the two-wheeler ownership goes down, cycle ownership becomes negligible. Very clear data we are getting on that. Now, we find that the maximum, again, like I highlighted before, if you look at office and education, these are daily trips. And again, this is corroborated by the frequency. We ask them, do you use the auto rickshaw daily? Do you use it once every 15 days, once a week? Trying to understand that most of the people who are going on auto rickshaws use it daily, so it's a part of their daily commute pattern, right? And the ones who are going daily are the ones who also own their own vehicles. So So they had the opportunity already and take the questions. So they had the opportunity to again use other modes of transport. So we highlighted this before that most of them are office and education trips and they are daily trips. Now if you look at it in terms of trip distances, that most of the people who are say office commuters, just if we just look at the office commuters, that is the yellow, mustard yellow kind of bar, most of them are between 2.5, 2.6 to 5 kilometers. So that's the kind of trip distances are going to work on a daily commute, right? 5 to 10 also. So a lot of people, if you look at the red, which is education, towards a shorter trip length you have more people. The work trip lengths are slightly longer. But you have people traveling, using auto rickshaws, even as much as over 15 kilometers. So they are still using the auto rickshaws. Which kind of negates the whole issue that auto rickshaw only works as a freedom. Again, we have detailed trip diaries, which we are yet analyzing, where people, we ask them so to understand where is the auto rickshaw, will you fit in their daily trip practice? They say, we walk to auto rickshaw stand, then we take an auto rickshaw, then we take a bus. Or we take, walk to auto rickshaw stand, we take an auto rickshaw, then we take another auto rickshaw, then we take another auto rickshaw, and each way we have to reach. So, auto rickshaw pretty much, whether it's one trip or multiple trips, becomes the mainline mode for them, and they access it by walking, etc. And some of them also use it to access public transit. So the role of auto rickshaw is not only limited as a feeder service to public transit, it also works as an end-to-end mobility for a lot of people, especially people who are doing this daily. We try to understand if there is a difference gender-wise. And there we got some interesting data. If we just look at, say, the office work groups and disaggregate them by men and women, we find that about 40% are females and 60% are males. Now, slightly less women traveling than men, but still a high percentage of women traveling to work by auto rickshaw. Even from the perspective of the female work participation ratio, if you take it from the census, it's about 18%. Then the usage of auto rickshaws is disproportionately high by women. So that raises a very interesting question in terms of mobility, that it allows women to travel to work, right? And there are several reasons for that, and we come to those reasons. But the fact is that A, if there is even the opportunity of another mobility mode like a two-wheeler or a car, if there is one car in the household, usually the woman would not have access to it. If there are multiple trip-making patterns that a woman has to do, or she may have traveled actually shorter distances than men, then the auto rickshaw and the fact that even if there is no mode of transport, the men still may be able to fight out the crowded buses, but the women would prefer to take the auto rickshaw, even if it means that they face slightly more. So there's this gender dimension of this mobility service the auto rickshaw gives it, which is
quite women go to work and then women also education and others.
Yeah.
More or less the same.
Yeah, it's more or less the same. It is, I'm not saying. So there is, in education trips, women are, the girls are going to college. But if you look at it from a work participation ratio, I was just saying how many women are in the workforce. And just trying to flag out issues. Like how many women are there in the workforce? And do they have equal opportunity to all mobility system? Then it seems that the rickshaw could be serving them. Now this is something that we have substantiated from other studies in other cities. That cycle rickshaws and auto rickshaws, IPT modes, are preferred by women compared to public transit, and they often don't have access to private transit.
So is that because they carry their children to school? They have to take their children to school. And that's why they use the auto rickshaws.
It is
children find it easier.
No, it is not only that. Women have a multiple trip chain making kind of practice. effect of movement. So women don't go to office and come back from office. They might drop their child on the way, go to office in the afternoon, get out, do some shopping, go back. With the evening, they may visit their sick mother-in-law, stop to buy groceries. So there's a multiple trip-making pattern that a woman does trip chaining. This is an established kind of a mobility system, which the auto enables, but the bus doesn't. You can't keep on getting on the bus, off the bus, on the bus, off the bus, doing, sometimes carrying groceries, sometimes having children, you know, going as near as possible to wherever you want to go. So the enabling process the operation gives to the women's mobility seems to be corroborated by these numbers. Again, we are kind of making estimates, guesstimates from a lot of research that we've done, seeing what these numbers are trying to say. But all in all, this is an important thing that we would like to
know. Are you planning to correlate this taking of, this disproportion with the comfort or safety factor of IPTs compared to, say, public transport? At least definitely the comfort factor would probably play a role.
So we asked them, so we'll just come to that a little later. Now, if you look at it from the perspective of personal income versus transport expenditure, we find that most people who are using auto rickshaws spend about 2%, 4% of their income on auto rickshaws. So it's a cheap mode of transport. It's not a very expensive mode of transport. That is an important thing to get to plan. Now, if we look at the problems, we asked the auto rickshaw users, what are the problems that we face? About 62% of people said, yes, we have problems. So the rest didn't really have major problems. So of the people who said they have problems, the biggest problem was exact change. That is the biggest problem that was highlighted. That, you know, there is a huge problem with exact change. And in fact, the last time we were here and we were collecting data, we were on an auto rickshaw where an older woman had just gotten out. And she needed to pay 4 rupees to the auto-rickshaw driver. And she was holding a 10 rupee in her hand and told the auto-rickshaw driver, give me 6 rupees, then I'll give you this 10 rupees. He said, I don't have change. She said, I'm not going to give you this 10 rupees. You give me the change. He says, you have to give me the money. She said, I won't pay you till you give me the 6 rupees back. We had about a 15-minute conversation on the lack of change, and finally everybody else was getting reasonably antsy. And the auto rickshaw driver just said, okay, just forget it. Don't give me the money because I have to go on. Right? So, this is anecdotal, completely something that happened in front of us. But it works, it probably works both ways. You know, the auto rickshaw drivers may not pay that, the money that is left over, the passengers may not pay. But that whole squabbling over exact change is apparently a big issue. And fares are so low. The possibility of carrying those exact change. If you are a daily commuter, you should be carrying it, but if not, then pick up the job. The other problem people had also was driver behavior and the frequency. Now again, that is interesting because the frequency of auto rickshaws is reasonably high, right? Still there is a demand for more. They still think, the users still think that the auto rickshaw frequency is low, or it's infrequent. The other interesting thing which was being highlighted in the morning, operationally for us, was that the starters maintain frequency. So they ensure that there is no bunching, so no five auto-rickshaws don't go together and then you don't have any operation. They ensure that there is a interval, there is a space out there. And there is a ceiling, so obviously we have very few. We have some official routes, some official people operating, some unofficial people operating within those routes. The starters are trying to maintain the frequency, and still the people are complaining they are not getting operations.
I think frequency also depends on the time of the day, because on the peak of peak, it just comes into play.
Agreed. And in the afternoon, they may not be here. So now, the fact is that 30% is reasonably still high for people to say that frequency is an issue. So if it is off-peak, frequency is not good, that also should be there because it is not only your... So that operationally leads us to the question that how do you manage off-peak frequency? The startups are not interested, people are not interested, there is not enough money. What do you do? If it's only market driven, you can't maintain offering frequencies.
Excuse me. Did you give these options to choose from problems? Or
yes.
Are they open ended?
No. These were options. And then he had
other options. The reason why I asked, because you brought in the gender issue.
Yeah.
Because if you're comparing a woman traveling by public transport and a woman traveling by an auto, and if the option was gender-based harassment, an auto is a much safer place for a woman traveling.
Yes.
But at this age, I hesitate to travel in buses,
yeah.
Even short distances, but I'm comfortable very late in the night, four people in the auto. So if you ever think of expanding it.
We did do that. That is our next issue.
In terms of the user survey, we've gone through a few, two or three versions of the user survey. So the first version had a few of these options and an open-ended question. And after we finished getting a fair number of responses, so like, problem of change was not something we actually had.
No, it came
but
up.
It
yeah.
came up, and so we added it. Yes.
It's not a problem, but then it's one of the
advantages.
It is in comparison to a public.
It is a problem. Which, so basically, from the field book stuff that came back, we did put them as options later.
So then, what we next slide? We try to disaggregate the problems by gender, and surprisingly, women don't have a problem so much with driver behavior as men. So men feel that drivers are rude,
yeah.
But women are better off. They have problem with exact change, as men do. So exact change is the overriding problem. We also have frequency is really an issue. The interesting thing was that it seems that driver behavior is more of a problem with men than with women.
So
it corroborates exactly what you know. You were
maybe the drivers. Are more wary of women
with, say, Delhi, I would say the point-to-point thing has made the autos more safe, much safe, because the Delhi, there was point of time in the Delhi auto, whenever you take an auto for a long distance
all
alone, then obviously the safety issue becomes much more problem.
Point-to-point and occupancy.
Yeah,
so the crowds create for safety. You're alone without a rickshaw driver, that doesn't create for safety. So you get the advantages of a public transport without the disadvantages of public transport. So the intermediate public transport, or the IPT as we call it, is a very interesting animal which provides mobility for safety. So we ask them, why don't you use the bus instead? And mostly they said the buses are just too crowded. The other issues are that the buses have low frequency. The auto at least has higher frequency than the buses on the routes that they are going on. And the journeys are not on bus routes. So the bus system doesn't get them from the point of origin to destination, but the auto, whether by changing one or changing two or changing three, they are able to negotiate almost up to the doorstep where they want. Even though Kolkata is one place we've seen that the bus route density is fairly high, especially in the city center, not so much in the periphery. Even in the small roads, the buses do come in. But it seems the auto rickshaw still provides a better service. The buses are too crowded. We ask them that a lot of them are going very short distances on auto rickshaws. Why don't you just cycle instead? You know, that kind of thing.
It was said that
if I'm not the cycle, and these are the people who own the cycle. We have discarded the people who do not own the cycle, so the possibility doesn't exist on that one. But mostly they are saying that it's really inconvenient and it's unsafe on our roads to the cycle.
There is also, I think, if you were talking about the inconvenience issue, I think a lot of people who are owning cycles, at least in Calcutta or in Kolkata, Bengals, but traveling by cycle also has a slightly a status connotation,
yeah.
Which I think will play a considerably big role. I mean, even if people own a cycle, they would probably want to ride that cycle to work, because there is an underlying assumption that people who are riding cycles to work belong to a certain strata of society and not higher than that. They will try to pass it off as inconvenience.
So it seems that auto rickshaws don't suffer from that image issue.
Yeah. It's not an extended.
Right? So which is the interesting thing, you know, so because say for example in a lot of the other cities in Delhi, traveling by public buses is as bad as traveling by bicycles in terms of your status, right? But that doesn't, so traveling by auto rickshaw is a better status than traveling by bicycle, maybe.
Maybe it's also an infrastructure problem because you don't have parking. If you are using it also as a feeder, then you can't ride, you go to the metro by riding the bike.
Absolutely.
Parking the bicycle.
No, that is one of the other reasons that we asked, but mostly they would have come up and said that even if you take a cycle, you will be parked. So, but the interest in cycling is not there. They find it inconvenient and unsafe, mostly.
Yes. There is another issue now that certain roads you can't.
It's banned, yes. Then that is
the police doesn't allow.
The police doesn't allow.
It's the most environment degree thing that the police can
yes,
not allow cycling.
Exactly. It's the most environment and regressive policy. And because again, a lot of were short distances and it's quite, you know, it takes as much time go in the traffic in many parts of Kolkata than to walk, you know, at certain times. We ask why do we not walk? Again, unsafe, climate is not suitable, or it's time is too far, or it's really bad.
Probably you should include that reason also, your reasons for not cycling.
That is bad.
No, that certain roads don't allow.
Yeah, so, right. Certain roads don't allow, but it didn't come out from the user's end. This is all just the answers from the users.
I know the
other
users.
Safety.
Because the safety aspect.
So additionally, we had the others categories, so we tried to disaggregate that. So they don't opt for buses also because they find waters is faster, so their travel time is less if you're taking an auto. Bus stops at every stop and there's a lot of delays, so you have less delays, you have auto shuttle. And you get a seat. That's a big attraction. You get a place to sit in an auto rickshaw. Again, for cycling, a lot of people said that, you know, this is not like that. So, you have people, mostly people who are moving in auto rickshaw are 31, 40, and over the half an hour. And again, they're too tired to walk. So, what we try to see from not only the user responses but also the literature that we saw, the studies that we saw, what are the possible benefits of using an auto rickshaw? One is that it can go on very small access roads. So it can really take you up to your destination much more than a public transit could. It has better last mile access than buses. You can always walk to an auto rickshaw stand. Bus stop maybe a little far, metro maybe much further off. It can act as a mainline port, so you can do a road trip by auto rickshaw, or you can use it as a last mile to public transit. In Kolkata, it works like a seamless transport system. Boarding and alighting is very easy. Even if you look at it from just the stepping up point of view, I wear a sari and I step up on a bus or I step into auto rickshaw, just the ease of boarding and alighting, less crowding, women and elderly would especially find that attractive place to sit, etc. It's also a source of livelihood. So we see a lot of benefits. The two benefits that we try to quantify to see if the benefits of rickshaws are giving to the transport system is saving emissions, right? And saving space. Okay. And we try to quantify that. And like I highlighted, about 37% of the people who are driving the auto rickshaws have the opportunity to either go by car or use the two-wheeler. So we took that data of the trip that they were making, the distance they were traveling, how many people, so if you look at emissions specifically, we said that if you look at avoided two-wheeler trips, if the people who had two-wheelers were not using the auto rickshaw and got onto the two-wheelers,
is that carbon monoxide or gas?
This is monoxide, that is dioxide. So we've calculated for both monoxide and dioxide. And so we've said that the CO2 emissions, the CO emissions are, this is a per day emissions. So 240 kgs per day, CO emissions and about 1.7 tons of CO2 emissions per day just by avoiding two-wheeler routes, right? So we have a fairly detailed methodology of the calculation. I'm happy to go into it if anybody wants to next. If you look at the four-wheelers, that even becomes more, right? Now, because we are looking at it not only from the trip distances, but occupancy, right? So you it immediately becomes so many times. So again, if you look at it from just the CO2 emissions, about 70 tons of CO2 emissions.
Sorry, another interruption. We are looking at three-wheelers moving on gas, right?
On LPG. So this is the current situation where three-wheelers are moving on LPG. And for the four-wheelers, we have assumed petrol. We are not even put diesel in the calculation. So this is a good calculation. It is even worse if you put diesel in the calculation. But we are just assuming that all the four-wheelers are by petrol. Are they self-regulating? Why?
Kind of terminuses. That
is the center.
No, but then the stops are here.
So they may be
the terminus is not there.
But the terminus is not there.
If you think of central Calcutta, then there are no terminuses. The terminus is Park Circus, the terminus is Kolkata. So there are no terminus. Unless there's a terminus,
there won't be a stop.
There won't be a stop. So that is.
So we already got the answer.
But there are several places, at least in South Calcutta, wherein without terminus also the starter is actually there.
Yeah.
I have actually seen, I mean, there are several such places, there are small, wherever there are
small. South Calcutta, there are a lot of starters.
Yeah, so I mean, even without terminus, they are there, their presence there.
So the terminus doesn't have
to be guessing things. They are all self-imposed. Starting and terminus.
It could be a cut route, they are not going till the.
So we actually also figured out that, you know, we've done this disaggregated analysis of how many cut routes, how many fracture routes, which are the official routes, so
and
we
which are the real routes,
which are the functioning routes. So we've tried to do all this mapping. We are still in the process again of doing this. So this it's promising to get even more interesting as it goes on further. That's pretty much about it. We are trying to compare what happened within the caves area with what is happening in the surrounding areas. So while we did these very detailed surveys within the KMC areas for the routes, for the surrounding peripheral districts, we did HEDs to just understand. So if you look at it, in KMC clearly we have auto rickshaw, which runs by MPG, and we have taxi. But if you look at the periphery of the city, then the variety of the auto rickshaw kinds of variants, or the taxi kind of variants, or the shared deal kind of variants is very high. So Tata Magic, and these are my models. They have spatial kind of segregation. Some areas have more focus on one type, some on the other type. And the interesting thing that has come out is the totals, which are the electric auto rickshaws, which are now becoming more and more popular. They very easily came out more because they didn't need earlier a license system, and I think you just talked about from this year onwards,
they are now mostly because of political pressure, because the auto unions strenuously objected to that totals being allowed to be made.
So they don't come inside the KMC area. All of these vehicles. By operation, unions are not allowed to enter the PMC
parties.
Yeah. So they are just around the PMC area. Next. So what we just try to just again preliminary thing say, what is the difference in which the way they are run within the PMC area and the way these systems are being run outside the PMC areas. And one stops me, there's a variety of vehicles, but there's also a variety of fuel types. So the air pollution levels, etc., differentials are completely different in the periphery of the city. Very few of them take permits in the peripheral areas. A lot of permits is by this union permits, not the PVD official permits. The committees kind of get together and decide. So they have auto rickshaw committees which decide this kind of thing. Routes, while the routes are defined in some areas, for some of them they don't even have defined routes. So it varies district by district. And within the KMC area, clearly the union or driver committees control, they have also the involvement of a kind of a driver committee or a union or something. Something is there. So it is, while the official legal functioning is not there, but still a more union-based or people-based or committee-based kind of approach is there. And there is a lot of threat by other modes coming in. So the totals are threatening the Tata Magics. So there's a lot of inter-competition between the different IPT modes. The whole narrative of administration, legality, routing is evolving in the peripheral areas. Very much, I guess, the way it started evolving in AP3 event, it started coming in the main city area. And this may be the right time to step in and start thinking about a lot of these issues of
how to structure the activity services within the city and outside the city. So we can, so just want to leave some, again, some questions for you. We had some questions raised by the morning session where we had talked about formal systems versus informal systems, what needs to be regulated, what are the systems, how in this regulatory or institutional environment, where do the unions, the agents, the political parties, where do they fit in? Where can they fit in? Planning or regulatory systems have never been in participation process before. And the urban transport function is with the state government. Technically, the state regulates, it's not even the city which gets to regulate fares. The state is supposed to regulate fares. So in Kolkata, the unions are regulating fares, that is certainly a very high flexibility of fare revision that is there, which is not there in many other parts of the country. Because state regulates, state, how will it regulate, how will it increase, when will it increase, this becomes a very cumbersome kind of a process. The fact that it works at a very disaggregated level in Kolkata is value that it provides in terms of efficiency, where even the drivers are satisfied with the fares that they are paying. They are not dissatisfied. That is one of our needs. They are okay. That is because of the flexibility of the fare revision. The fare, if there is a hike in fuel prices, you hike the fares. It doesn't take you a year to bring in that hike because it's a state-driven kind of process. So, some of the issues that were raised by the users, etc., we tried to just throw in some possibilities formalizing the operations, not only formalizing the institution structure, but should we look at more formal designs and locations of stands, because that is a usual part. Stops, where to stop right now, you put a hand in, just stop anywhere. Roughly the area is different. More or less people know where to stand, so the auto rickshaw will stop there. But should it be built in as a part of the design of the street? You know, that you have a space for auto rickshaw and buildings, a kind of a nearby, a kind of a stop or whichever way. Fair also, how formal should it be? Who gets to design? How does it get revised? Now frequency and schedule fixing. Starters are playing the amazing function. So that kind of flexibility, can we bring it if we formalize the system? Where on demand, you can increase or decrease the frequency. On, you know, so it's a dynamic frequency setting. Very highly evolved in terms of weight functions and very participatory in the way it is designed. So how do we bring that into an operations plan? Would GPS help? In many other cities now, they are putting GPS on auto rickshaws. Delhi has been used to it. Will GPS help in monitoring whether the auto rickshaws are doing the full routes, they are doing half routes, they are not going, you know? So will that help? Should there be GPS on auto rickshaws? This business of change, how does one work that out? Right? Should we look at smart cards, debit cards, PTM? We pay there are models existing. We are not pulling this out of the, out of some other countries. This, there are models existing in other parallel transport modes. Easier said than done. It's a very complicated process. Should it be both? Maybe if you have the change, great, pay by cash. If not, yeah, should you be able to swipe a kind of card? Can you have a monthly membership pass if you are a daily commuter, which allows you rights to all auto rickshaws, but then how will the revenue be shared? Questions like that. And driver, right now, if a driver is not behaving well, a union, a starter, somebody tries to resolve the problem. A more formal grievance redressal system, would that make the life of everybody a little bit more easier? So, just leave, again, throwing the floor open now. New questions if there are parts of the presentations. But now also questions on the formal versus informal dialogue in both institutional regulation as well as professional.